I'd like to introduce you, give a nice warm welcome to Philip, Dr. Robert.
Warm welcome, and to Whitey's for inviting me back to my old stomping ground, which was doing women-friendly cafes and conversations all around Scotland. And to talk about baking, I would just like to thank my husband, who's parked in the back row, who literally drove and baked for Independence. He's German, he makes really good German tea cake, which in our neck of the woods is known in Ayrshire as Hans's cake. And he didn't bring any today, because you don't need any more. But in essence, in 2014, everybody did what it was that they could do, and obviously I'm a talker, as you'll have realised, and as he said, he can't do that, but he can drive me everywhere, and we drove 5,500 miles in 2014, and he baked tea cakes for all over the place, and I have a feeling that we're kind of starting to crank back up to that. Now, obviously, one of the things I want to talk about today is Brexit, because that's part of what's brought us back to where we are. And I totally understand that the public are already bored out of their mind with Brexit and listening to the complete burgh and shambles it is. Mm. And so people are just switching off. And we have an issue that people are going, well, I don't do business. I don't run a business, so it's got no relevance for me. I won't be importing, exporting, so I won't face tariffs. What people haven't even connected is the fact that your food is costing you more. It's because the pound has gone down, so things we import from elsewhere, and that can simply be coffee, we don't grow cocoa beans or coffee beans, are going to cost us more. So there's simple things like that. But one of my big concerns, and what I wrote about a lot before the referendum, not in a, oh my God, you will lose this, but a please be aware of what we have angle, is the benefits that we've had to health from being in the EU. What people don't realise is the cleaner water, the cleaner beaches, the cleaner air. Look at the whole argy-bargy last year, because Westminster had still not published its strategy for cleaning up inner city air. And the only thing that was pushing them was the EU saying, you're already breaking the deadlines, you need to do something. So this idea that they stand up and say, oh, we would do all of this ourselves, we don't need someone outside pushing us, is just simply not true. We also hear, oh, these things come to us from Brussels. Why are they telling us what to do? Now, that's not what it's like. That's what it's like sitting in Westminster, I can tell you. We are ruled from Westminster. We are not ruled from Brussels. Brussels is 28 countries working together on some of the biggest challenges Europe faces. Things that one country can't sort. The refugee crisis, the environment, climate change, terrorism. These things have to be done together. So when they go on about bureaucracy, at least 1/28 of those bureaucrats came from the UK. 1/28 of the ministers and commissioners came from the UK. So we were part of that. And in actual fact, because of the size of the UK, it had quite a big voice within the EU. It was Mrs. Thatcher who stimulated the drive towards the single market. There are lots of things where Britain has played a particularly big part, and yet now they talk as if it was enforced on them, and it's absolute nonsense. And my concern is that we have not got ordinary people in the street to understand the threat that Brexit actually poses to things we take for granted. The politicians go on about tariffs all the time. Now, even people who are interested in trade will tell you that actually, for most things, tariffs is very much the small part of it. It's things like regulations. So if we say, oh yes, we're going to make our light bulbs to meet European regulations, who's going to verify that our light bulbs meet European regulations? Because we'll no longer be part of the light bulb agency. It's the fact that we've worked together. And it's actually these agencies, like the European Medicines Agency, the EURATOM, the European Aviation Safety Agency. These are things that it's a much bigger deal to be outside of. So while they talk about tariffs and trade, it's the rights and opportunities we've had to live and work and marry and love and settle anywhere we wanted that we're taking away from the next generation. Many of you know that my husband's German, as I said. His mother was Polish and his father was German. They met during the war and they weren't allowed to marry. They had a son together who was taken away from them. His mother was a forced labourer. His father was arrested by the Gestapo because he was with a Polish woman. Now, they were eventually allowed to marry right at the end of the war. But as Hans used to say, long before this nonsense happened, in one generation, he could marry who he loved, and live where he liked, and carry out his profession where he wanted. And we are taking that away. And those are the things that we need to be talking to people about. The staff in our NHS and social care who come from Europe, who've worked with us for years. Hans is a GP, he's been here 32 years. 19 months on, EU nationals here don't know what their rights will be. We've had a 90% drop in EU nurses registering to come to the UK. Well, would you? Would you go to a country that has a big sign on it saying, "Nay foreigners"? So we have made the UK feel unwelcome. And all the talk about, oh, don't panic, they'll be fine. And then we have David Davis, literally days after the Phase 1 agreement on citizens, going, oh no, it's only really a declaration of intent, it's not legally binding. Is it any wonder that 20% of doctors in England and 14% of doctors in Scotland from the EU are already in the process of leaving? And these are the things that we have to talk about. Because I don't care what walk of life you're in, this will affect you. If there is not a social care worker to help look after your grandma, then that will affect you, because she'll either be stuck in hospital or in a home, or you'll be having to make up the gap. The access to drugs that we have through the European Medicines Agency, which works right across the EU, so new drugs are checked and licensed all in one go for the whole of the EU, indeed for the whole EEA. That means that new drugs are launched in Europe almost immediately after they're launched in America. Canada and Australia get drugs 6 months to a year later. Other smaller countries, it's much further behind. So we're saying to pharma, right, okay, you're going to launch US and EU, but then you're going to have to pay another whole big fee and go through another whole set of loops to license your drug here in the UK. And what they're saying to me is, well, we're probably not going to rush, because with new expensive drugs, it always takes years before they get into the NHS. So it won't just be 6 months or a year later. It might be further back. And because drug licensing is reserved, it's a UK matter. For us in Scotland, even if the Scottish Medicines Consortium said, actually, that is a good drug, we would like to pass it. It's an unlicensed drug in the UK. Doctors won't be able to use it. So we have benefited from actually working together as 28 countries. Now, I'm not pretending there aren't things that need sorted in the EU. The biggest supporter of the EU wouldn't pretend that. But we didn't ever give the EU credit for anything. And that's why we ended up across the UK with this vote to leave. Because all we had was stories of straight bananas, bureaucracy, and being forced to do things we didn't want. Not recognition of our fundamental rights, maternity leave improvements, paternity leave, all of these things came about because of the EU. And the idea that we would get anything like that from a Tory government in Westminster is just cloud cuckoo land, I'm afraid. And the problem is at the moment, obviously all they plan to do is move it across. But be in no doubt that they will then start picking it off like carrion over the next 5 or 10 years. Because many of them in Westminster are talking about, well, then we can be a low regulation, nimble economy like, you know, Singapore or Taiwan or whatever. And therefore we'll see more of the gig economy. We'll see more young people who never get beyond working for Uber or Deliveroo or whatever it is. And we need to be thinking about what we're doing to that next generation, because it's them that particularly wanted to stay in Europe. It's them that are going to be hit most by the changes. So we need to find ways of unpacking Brexit for people in simple language and talking about what does it actually mean for the person in the street. One of the biggest things that it didn't get credit for is actually the longest period of peace and stability in Europe and in Europe's entire history. Mm-hmm. Now, David Cameron, to be fair to him, did try to raise it, and everyone went, oh, that's nonsense, you're scaremongering talking about World War III. But at the end of the wars in the Balkans, we could still have had all of that ethnic violence just grumbling on and on and on. Northern Ireland, where I'm from, we were killing each other for 30 years. The idea that, you know, you have a war for a few years and it just naturally stops. No, it doesn't. What dragged the Balkans into being modern democracies was the chance of getting into Europe. There's a big bright light. If you become a modern democracy, you can get in. We will support you with regional funding. We will help you develop. And it's the same when the East opened up and came out from behind the Iron Curtain. Again, we could have had all sorts of scores to be settled, all sorts of friction, but it was exactly the same offer. If you become a modern, democratic country, you will have the chance to be in the EU. And again, we could have been having violence erupting in Eastern Europe for years and years. No credit for that whatsoever. And yet that was the original idea after the Second World War, was to try and integrate Europe to a point where it would never go back to killing each other. Now, I'm not saying that that's what we would do, but there are lots of frictions and differences, and the EU is what has given them the chance to be dealt with. The peace process in Ireland started because Bertie Ahern and John Major got to meet in Europe in neutral territory and just found that they got on. They became really good friends. They said, we could do business. And that was the start of what led to the Good Friday Agreement. Europe has funded the peace process in Ireland to a massive degree. And in the 20th year of the Good Friday Agreement, which is this year, we see it under threat. Under threat because of the possible recreation of a border. Under threat because in a snap election, the two moderate parties, SDLP and Ulster Unionists, disappear, leaving us with Sinn Féin at one end and DUP at the other. Sinn Féin don't take their seats, so you only have one side of the community and a fairly extreme version of that side of the community that have any voice. And then what do? You hand the entire whip hand of the UK government over to them. The threat to peace in Northern Ireland is unbelievable, and people are frightened. And it just shows the utter lack of interest, the utter contempt for the other nations of the UK. Nobody was interested in thinking through the impact of their decisions. That shows you the lack of interest in an area of the United Kingdom that was torn by violence for 30 years. Is it any wonder that they do not care about the impact on Scotland? And again, you'll be hearing over this last week or so what all this kind of kerfuffle about Clause 11, what does Clause 11 mean? Now, for people who are political geeks or have been watching Parliament Live, you may understand what it means, which is that instead of powers that are sitting in Europe that are related to devolved powers coming to Edinburgh, Belfast and Cardiff, they're going to Westminster. And also within that Clause 11 is no commitment as to when they might be devolved back out to the devolved administrations. And also within Clause 11 gives power, delegated powers to UK ministers to actually change Scottish laws without even having to consult with our ministers. So literally, they can change our laws without us having any control or impact at all. Now, the problem with that, even before you get to will they willfully undermine our laws or not, is it's a reversal of the principle of devolution. Devolution settlement in 1998 was very simple. Certain powers were reserved to Westminster. So welfare, foreign affairs, defence, macroeconomics, etc. And everything that they did not explicitly reserve was devolved. Anything else was to come to us. And that is a devolved settlement. What Wales had at first was conferred powers, which is they got given specific things by the graciousness of whoever was in number 10. That was changed for Wales back in 2006. What this Clause 11 does is it reverses it. These powers go to Westminster, and we have to sit like a wee puppy with our paws up and our hands out, waiting for when they might pass those powers on. Now, if you had a respect for devolution, the powers should go to where they belong. And then the four governments could sit around the table and agree what kind of frameworks need to be common. But you would respect devolution in that those four governments would come with their voices to make a decision. No, they want it to go to number 10, and they will hand out what the frameworks will be. And that is just not acceptable. And I can tell you, going to NFU meetings of farmers, many of whom voted Leave, many we know voted No in 2014, many of whom vote Conservative, but the idea of Scottish hill farming being run from Westminster through a framework designed for the big agribusinesses of the southeast of England is something that they find utterly unacceptable. These powers were devolved because we know what we need, and our farming, our fishing, etc., is utterly different from what happens in England, and therefore we need these powers here. And Clause 11 literally threatens all of what we've had since 1999. And we need to make sure that we're fighting. Obviously, we're making as much noise about it. We had the 12 new Tories all stand up and say, Clause 11 is unacceptable, and then waltz through the lobby to vote it. They said, we trust the government. We know they'll bring an amendment back at the report stage. David Mundell promised he'd bring an amendment back at the report stage. Well, I tell you, we've just had the report stage. It is unchanged. So they all stood up and said how disappointed they were in their government that they didn't bring it back. But they still traipsed through the lobbies and voted it through. So now we have to hope they do as they promise and they'll amend it in the Lords. So Michelle Moan and Alan Sugar have more impact. 26 bishops have more impact. Not just in Scotland's governing party, which is the SNP, because we do not take seats in the Lords, but all the Scottish MPs, we will have no voice in that debate. And while they're saying, oh yes, but it will be coming back to the House, yeah, it comes back for like 5 minutes, and you have very little chance of changing it at the 11th hour. And it is not acceptable to allow them to undermine our Parliament. And we need to get people to understand, it's not just that we're not moving further forward over self-determination. There's an enormous threat that we move backwards. As they used to admit, the whole reason to give the Scottish Parliament was to try and destroy the drive for independence in the first place. Well, clearly that didn't quite work out the way they expected. So what Clause 11 will do is give them the powers to just cut the legs away from the Scottish Parliament and undermine, because what they think is, well, that didn't solve it, so let's shut it down. And we're seeing it in all sorts of things, from, you know, British haggis and British whiskey, you know, all of this kind of thing. It's literally trying to get rid of the word Scotland. And we can't allow that. So we need to be opening that up to people. We need to realise the democratic deficit that Scotland faces. We voted to remain. We voted very clearly to remain. And yet, it doesn't matter. There's no one interested in paying the slightest bit of attention. On the 22nd of December 2016, the Scottish Government put forward Scotland's place in Europe, which put forward the compromise to say we accept staying in the UK if we can stay in the European Economic Area, like Norway. So we'd still be in the single market. We'd still be either, they offered even in or out of the customs union, whatever would make it more practical. But that Scotland cannot afford to be utterly severed from Europe. The impact on Scotland is expected to be higher than any other part of the UK, other than perhaps Northern Ireland, where obviously the threat is, as I've said, quite existential. So we need to try and unpack this for people. We need to get people talking about this, because it's exactly the same for us. You vote for your MPs, and sometimes we wonder why we bother. Because we go down there and we debate as hard as we can, we work really hard, we speak up and everything, but we're less than 10% of the House. There is nothing where we can make something happen. And it's not just Brexit. Brexit is just the last in a long line of big decisions that Scotland would never have done to itself. As Nicola says, we would never, excuse me, still recovering from the learn. We would never have parked weapons of mass destruction 30 miles from our biggest city. There's no way Scottish government of any colour would have made such a decision. We would not have done Brexit. We would probably not have gone into Iraq. Do we get any chance to talk about these things? No, we don't. The £320 billion of oil revenue, would we have squandered that on unemployment benefit instead of investing it in infrastructure and modernising our industries? No, we wouldn't. Would we have squandered it without saving a single brass farthing in a sovereign oil fund? No, we wouldn't. So from literally going back to Trident, to the oil, to Brexit, what Scotland needs simply doesn't matter to Westminster. And that is the issue. That's what the next referendum will be about. It's not going to be about all the things we might do and all the great things we would have a chance. We will actually have to narrow the discussion down and focus on Scotland having self-determination. Because that's actually all it's about. Is that if Scotland was independent, we would take the decisions about the country we live in, the country we are committed to. And if the politicians we would put in Holyrood to make those decisions don't do what we want, we can boot them out. We can't boot out the government in Westminster. And that's one of the big differences. You should always be able to get rid of the politicians that you think are not doing a good job. And we can't do that. So when we move forward, we need to be moving forward with very much just a conversation about, could we? Could Scotland survive as an independent country? And that means talking about the resources, the physical resources, the monetary resources, and the human resources and creativity that we have that mean that we actually are utterly in a position to be not just a viable, but a successful country. And we need to be having those conversations. Now, beyond that, there will be a couple that unfortunately are just hangovers from 2014, but have to be dealt with because they're things that cause concern to people who voted no. One of them is the currency. Now, being from Northern Ireland, I just never understood how that got to be a thing. All of us who lived before the 70s have been through a much bigger change of currency than we would face. And that was decimalisation. Because we were walking around going, how much is that in real old money? Well, I wasn't. I was only, whatever I was, 12 or something at the time. But old ladies were coming in going, how much is that in old real money, sonny? So that was actually a big change. The name of what you have in your pocket is less important. But in Northern Ireland, lots of shops took the pound and the punt, the Irish pound. When Ireland was changing to the euro, we took the pound, the punt and the euro. These days with plastic, it is just so utterly irrelevant what your currency is. And yet we allowed that to become a big thing. And that's something where hopefully when the Growth Commission report comes out, we will have their advice. To me, I always felt it was relatively straightforward. You cannot go straight into the euro other than from your own currency. And you need time to set your own currency up. And once they said that, oh, it's our pound and you can't have it, only in a posh London accent, or whatever accent George Osborne has, that's fine. It's an internationally tradable currency. So the first step is that you will keep the pound. But you say, we're keeping it for so many years while we set up our own currency. And then we'll decide. And for most things that happen after independence, the whole point is, then we'll decide, because we'll be making the decision. And the other one is that we have to stop the lie that was told to elderly people living on the road. If it's a yes on Thursday, there'll be no pension next week. And where I worked, I had nurses coming into my hospital saying that they had folk knocking their doors of their aunties and their grannies and telling them that. It's a yes on Thursday, there'll be no pension next week. Now, if you're a widow living on your own, and that is your only income, you cannot blame anybody for voting no around that. But we need to make sure that we work out why people voted no and try and help to assuage their anxiety, to reassure them, to answer their questions. And that's why, for me, I think this is the most critical year. I'm calling this the year of conversation. because this is not the year of marches with flags. It's not even necessarily the year of lots of leaflets through doors. It's every one of you thinking about those relatives and friends who voted no and just asking them, why did you vote no? What was it you were anxious about? Can I answer your question? If I can't, can I find out the answer? And having a conversation. And part of having a conversation is listening. We need to listen to the people who voted no. Now, I don't mean people who sleep in red, white and blue pyjamas. They are utterly committed to the United Kingdom, and that won't change. And we just have to respect that. And I would say to people who are active on social media, or people you know who are active on social media, please do not be rude to people. You might think, oh, I'm arguing with an absolute nutter and I'm going to give it to them. You will not change them. But the problem is there are other people who voted no, who see the language you're using and think that's how you would talk to them. They don't see, actually, that guy's a troll, and it's fair enough to say that. They just see that's how you talk to people who voted no. So don't go around talking about no voters and quizzlings and you yes yet and all of this kind of stuff. Even our movement yes too, and I totally understand that. But remember, for people who weren't part of Yes One, that for them it isn't Yes Two. And that's why Nicola calls it ScotRef and not Indy Two. So it's important that we think about it. We believe in independence. We know that given the chance, Scotland could start to deal with the problems we have and open up the potential in the future. But it's not us that are going to change that vote by how we vote. We're going to change that vote by how we change people's minds. And you do not change people's minds by shouting and bawling at them. So absolutely, events that are conversations, inviting people in, and Women Friendly is crucial to that, because women do not like debates that are based on shouting and aggression. And men, we always keep you under control in these events. You know, if you get hold of a microphone, no woman is getting to ask a question.
So, you don't know my wife.
And Women for Independence had a huge impact in the first referendum, because women were way behind in support for independence. And yet, at the end of the day, they were only 3% behind the men. So we need to get active now. This sitting, I read it in the paper, when is Nicola going to call the referendum? So we get started. Guys, why are you not started already? This is the time. We are not changing people's hearts and minds by the end of 2018. Then we're already sliding backwards. So talk to your relatives that you know voted no. Talk to your neighbours, your friends, the people at work. As Margo MacDonald, God rest her, said, if everyone converted one person, we'd already have been independent. So be gentle with it. Reach out to people and have conversations, not having arguments. And that's how we'll change things. So I wish all of you the best in 2018. We're depending on all of you to make sure that we get our organisations moving, that we're going forward, but that we're reaching out with a hand and not a fist, that we are sitting there with our ears open and not shouting and bawling at people. So thank you for coming, and obviously we'll take some Q&A now. Thank you very much.
Marion Robertson, a question about the continuity bill, which is going to be debated next month in Holyrood. Is there any chance, according to the Sunday Herald journalist Ian McWhirter, who said that there's a good chance that if it's voted through, the continuity bill might unseat the process of Brexit in Scotland, along with, say, Northern Ireland and perhaps Wales?
the key issue about the continuity bill, I mean, we have to accept that there are things you have to deal with if Brexit's going forward, and it would be irresponsible of the Scottish Government to just go hashtag we're no gone, which is my hashtag, frankly. So you do have to be ready, or else a lot of our law, and particularly in Scotland, our law is based on EU law, would fall down, because the withdrawal bill is such a disaster, and we cannot support the withdrawal bill with clause 11 in it. Obviously they're now talking about doing a continuity bill. Wales is talking about doing its own continuity bill. Our continuity bill would not apply to Northern Ireland. It would give powers to ministers in Scotland, very similar to the withdrawal bill, is to correct things where at the moment a law refers to an EU body, etc. And if you do not correct that statute, it will cease to function. And that was the idea of it. But what they've done is they've packed the kitchen sink into it, and they've packed all of these things, as I say, huge amounts of powers going to the government. And instead of saying, we reserve the right to remove the words European Union every time it appears, they've just said, we have the power to amend legislation. And so there's lots of politicians in England are not happy with the withdrawal bill, because it gives the executive, i.e. the government, literally power for 2 years to do what they like. And the problem is it's given them powers over our laws as well. So the continuity bill is because we are, unless there's a massive change, we will be voting against it in Westminster, and Holyrood could not give it legislative consent in the form it's in, and therefore they need a replacement. And that's why they're going to start next month and prepare this continuity bill.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
I can hear that by your accent.
So yes, I'm one of those EU nationals who never bothered to take the British nationality for two reasons. One, that I didn't have to, and the second was that I don't want to swear allegiance to the Queen, because I'm actually a Republican, being French. So that would really have stuck in the craw to do such a thing. But actually, I was reading about various things about the settled status that we are supposed to apply for by the end of the year. But more to the point, I think a lot of the, and I read the Facebook page of the 3 million, and a lot of people are suddenly realising, I think a lot of EU nationals in Scotland are realising that even if they, when they voted no because they didn't want to come out of the EU. So I think, I don't quite know what the proportion of EU nationals in Scotland, I think it's maybe less than 1 million. But it's still quite a big population.
It's about 200,000.
200,000, right. So it is quite small. But still, if those 200,000 people voted yes, it could make quite a difference. So how do we, I mean, obviously, I'm quite vocal on that particular Facebook, but they're mainly based in England. So it is quite difficult to find a place where we could actually contact all of the EU nationals in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it might well be that we require some EU nationals to get together and look at setting up their own groups specifically in Scotland. Because the biggest solution for us and the biggest failure so far is we have not connected Brexit and independence. So you talk to people who are not Indie supporters about independence, oh my god, I can barely cope with Brexit, I can't face independence. No, if we were independent, we would choose not to do Brexit. And that was what happened in the snap election. We were meeting people on the doorstep who didn't see that the two were related in any way. So I think it is important that we have these campaigns, and there are some campaigns in Scotland going ahead. And certainly I think there are many EU nationals who voted no in 2014 who would now vote yes without any question, because that was the main driver. The problem that we have is, depending on when another referendum would be, they will be doing their best to have disenfranchised those EU nationals before then. And obviously, in their original proposal, EU nationals wouldn't have the right to vote for Scottish Parliament or even local elections. And so that clearly is there, that they see that that would be an extra couple of 100,000 who would be on the yes side that they want to disenfranchise. So it's important that we as politicians fight to protect your right to vote, but also that people who are from the EU originally are active and make sure they're talking to their colleagues. There are countries in Europe where you can't hold dual nationality. And up until 2009, Germany was one of them. So that's why Hans never even considered.
It's the same in France, actually, but I think I think it's obviously been possible for quite a while. I didn't know that, but quite a long time ago when I inquired, it wasn't possible.
But in Holland, I think you can't, and I think maybe Spain, I'm not sure. Right. So, for people for whom their original culture is important, they don't want to give that up. And this is the thing, they haven't had to. We've been able to live and work where we want without having to give up something of where we came from. So I think having groups that are specific to Scotland is quite important because our way forward is for us to become independent and to stay in Europe. And what's very clear when you're talking to politicians or dignitaries from Europe is they are ready to welcome us in. So the whole story of, oh, then you'll be out and you'll never get into Europe is absolutely not the case. There's huge support and recognition of Scotland's right to go into Europe.
Could you possibly run through the effects of Scottish NHS? Because at the moment there's a lot of talk about the threat of Westminster taking on the whole idea of the American health service and what that is going to do to the way we are set up and the threat to what we have here in Scotland.
Well, obviously, and I spoke a lot about it in 2014, this outsourcing drive that has really fragmented NHS England, and while I get called a liar for talking about it up here, if you listen to doctors and nurses in England, you know, there's a group of them who are taking Jeremy Hunt to court for a judicial review because they're trying to fight against this outsourcing and involvement of big private companies. Virgin Care is the second biggest provider after the government of care. And if you look, they still only run a relatively small proportion of NHS England, but in every year where contracts have to be put out to tender, last year 70% of those contracts went to private companies. So it's just, you know, exponentially nibbling away. What they plan at the moment, and at the moment they're planning to do this without any discussion in Westminster, is they are dividing England into 44 footprints. And they are encouraging what they call accountable care organisations. And this is a term that's used in the States, that you become a member of that. And the contracts that they advertised on the 4th of August have nothing in them that would stop that accountable care organisation being run by a big private company like Capita, like Virgin. So where we have a health board that plans for Ayrshire and Arran, where I live, you could have a private company at the top that is being handed literally billions of public money to deliver health and social care for an area. And they're going, oh, well, this is great, we can integrate it. I've nothing against the integration. I would like to see NHS England going back to place-based planning like we have, but to stick a private company at the top with its profits, with its ways of working, and then hand billions of taxpayers' money over to it would be wrong. And when we talked a lot in 2014 about the threat of TTIP and the fact that David Cameron would not put the NHS on that as being excluded from TTIP for a very particular reason. They want big private multinationals to come in. And Theresa May has now been asked several times, the last was just a few days ago, whether the NHS would be excluded from a Tory-Trump trade deal. You know, we thought TTIP was bad, but a Tory-Trump trade deal would trounce TTIP because the UK will be crawling off to America on its hands and knees begging for a trade deal so they can come back with a piece of paper. And that will be a threat to our farming, to our food and drink quality, everything. But if we have big companies like United Health coming in to run chunks of NHS England, the danger to us specifically is that they could challenge the border as being a non-tariff barrier because they could claim the United Kingdom is a unitary state. Why is that? Why are we kept out of that bit? And that is a threat. And that's exactly the same threat that would have existed from TTIP. Only I think it will be even worse in a Tory-Trump trade deal because I think they will not be looking at protections. They will just be looking at getting it, so that Liam Fox can go, you know, success in our time, we've got a trade deal. So I think that's the biggest threat from the point of view of privatisation. There is still the underlying threat that if they destroy NHS England, which they are working on doing, I'm not going to send a bag of money up here every year towards ours. And when people are telling you that, you know, oh, we've got free prescriptions and we've got Child Smile because they're so generous to us, the Scottish budget's been cut by over 9%. It's our government's decision to try and prioritise health and well-being. That's our choice. But just remind them of the $320 billion in oil money that's been going the other way. So this idea that Scotland is being tricked, that we sit here with an enamel tin getting, you know, kind of gracious money from London is not true. We pay everything to London and we get our pocket money back. And while it would be challenging at first, because of course we have a deficit, every country other than Norway's had a deficit since the crash, we would work our way out of that. And one thing I would say to everybody is, you know, it's not going to be the magic indie fairy. You're not going to wake up the day after and it'll all be perfect. We need to prepare for 10 years of hard work, of rolling our sleeves up to actually build the Scotland, build the economy, develop it how we want it to be. But imagine the honour that we would have to be that generation to deliver that to the future.
I have a question, again, related to the NHS and healthcare. What's your opinion on how much Brexit will impact recruitment and retention of EU doctors and nurses? Obviously, you spoke about the drop already. Like, how much do you think that will impact, so workforce planning initiatives within the healthcare sector?
I think it's a huge threat. I mean, even with our EU colleagues here, workforce is one of our biggest challenges. Now, all four NHSs in the UK, and if I can just emphasise that, there are four separate NHSs that are utterly different. Is workforce is one of the big challenges in all of them. And while we have difficulties, the vacancy rate for nurses in England is three times ours. So, I mean, it's just absolutely existential. We have wards that virtually have one nurse running them. So this is difficult right across the UK. And our three big challenges is we do have an ageing population, and that means there is more demand. We don't have enough staff, whether nursing or medical. And money's tight. There's no point in pretending that it's anything else. What Scotland doesn't have is we don't have one hand tied behind our back by this fragmentation that comes from the private companies. But to me, the challenge we should be focusing on is workforce. And about 7% of our staff come from the EU. To lose them would be catastrophic. But within nursing, and particularly social care, there's actually quite high turnover. It's usually classed as about 25%. So you've got about a quarter of nurses and social care workers who are actually going home each year. And that means you need more coming in to replace that. And that's what we're not seeing. We're seeing that flow, particularly among nurses, because they register so we can measure it. It's harder to measure for social care staff, is we're seeing that drying up. And as I said, regardless of what the final settled status is, at the moment, settled status does not equal what EU nationals have now. And the big thing is the xenophobia that is emanating from the UK. And we might be up here in Scotland going, "Not us, we love you, please come here." Nobody can hear our voice, because all they're hearing is the big voice that's saying we want to keep people out. And therefore, that is our challenge, that we're going to struggle to recruit people. And the further north you go in Scotland, the more you have a higher proportion of EU nationals. So if you go to Shetland or the Western Isles, you'll find actually the proportion of EU doctors is much higher than that. And while fewer are in the process of leaving, so here it's about 14% rather than 19%, and it's about a third that are thinking of leaving as opposed to 45%, we couldn't afford to lose a third of our EU doctors. So people are not feeling welcome. We've got friends, two German doctors down in Ayrshire, lived here 20 years, their three kids born and grown up, and they thought, let's get them British status, citizenship, and then we know they're okay. Eldest and youngest, given British citizenship, middle child refused. You know, like, the logic of that is, oh, if you'd filled in form 34/80 when he was born, that would have been fine. But when he was born, it was freedom of movement. No one mentioned form 34/80. So what are they talking about? Maybe we'd be better going back to Germany. Now, they don't want to. They're utterly settled here. But that is the feeling. And when I'm meeting EU doctors and indeed scientists and academics in Westminster, they're talking to me about their children being bullied at school.
Mm-hmm.
They're talking about feeling unwelcome and uncomfortable. They're talking about being afraid to speak to their children in their own language out in the street. Would you go and live somewhere like that? No, you wouldn't. And that's the problem. We have to try and make sure that we are overcoming that terrible message of unwelcome and hate that is emanating from the UK. And the government ministers can stand at the dispatch box and dismiss it, but that's what it's like out in the streets for people who live here. So the threat to us is significant. No matter how much we try and put out the positive message, the big neon message that's coming out from the UK is not wanted here.
I have a sort of follow-on question to that, and it's sort of linked to Ireland, because a lot of our doctors and nurses, our medical staff and our care staff come from Ireland, and they've always been able to come freely because there's been a pre-EU freedom of movement between Ireland and the UK. But if there isn't a solution found, which I frankly find quite challenging to imagine how they'd even do it, and if there is some restriction on freedom of movement between the EU and between the UK and Ireland, has any assessment been done on what impact that would have on the NHS here?
The impact would be even greater. But to be fair, I think because the common travel area does precede the EU, and obviously it was literally back around 1949, 1950, where people from Southern Ireland were not quite defined as foreign, I think they will try and find a way to do that. And what they're already saying around when they talk about the frictionless border in Ireland is that they would not be particularly, stopping people. They're saying they're not going to stop anything, but if it's a customs union border, they will have to stop goods, but that they may stop people, not stop people. And therefore, unless you're planning to simply shut down your tourism industry, you are going to have to allow people to come from other countries to visit the UK. And therefore, what they're much more likely to be doing, it'll be when you want to get a job, when you want to rent a house, etc., that you will then need proof of your right to remain. And the problem is, that's what means all EU nationals will need papers.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, so will we. You know, you can't just go, well, you have a bit of a foreign accent, you know, so we want to see your papers. What about the children of these German couple who will also have some degree of German accent? So unless there is a commitment in the UK for everyone to carry an ID card, it's going to be very difficult for any organisation to say, I want to see your papers but not yours. Are you foreign? Are you foreign? So all of this stuff just simply hasn't been touched on. But I think that we will have a more sensible agreement and arrangement with regards to Ireland. The challenge will actually be goods going over the border, because it's going to be an external customs union.
Put the hand up in the second row. I just a follow-on question about the workforce. Made it very clear what a threat the current xenophobia coming from Westminster and south of the border is. Do you have an idea how to counter it? How, you know, you're saying that's the big message, you know, keep out. And that's a big message in neon, but with the media as it is, general media, how do we go about countering that?
Well, obviously, the First Minister has always spoken very clearly, and I have to say, I was never prouder of her, and I'm often proud of her, than on the 24th of June, because the first thing she addressed, and the first people she addressed, was the EU nationals who are here, who are not just part of our health and social care or our universities, they're actually part of our communities, and have brought cultures that have actually enriched ours, and I was really proud of that. But it comes back to your comment about, you know, mobilising the EU nationals who live here, making sure they feel welcome, making sure the message they are sending back to Europe is that they are not finding their kids being bullied, that they are still welcome, that people are supporting them, that people are taking the trouble to reach out and make sure that they do not feel alienated by something they saw in the news that came from somewhere else. So I think both of those issues are related. And obviously any opportunity that we get, we need to make sure that people in Scotland recognise not just the contribution culturally or through their work, but the economic impact, which is billions that the EU nationals contribute to our economy. I mean, it's almost 5 billion is contributed by them. So this idea that, you know, people migrate into Scotland and just take, it's just nonsense. The people who come here are usually younger, they're usually working age, they may be having their children here. It's them that help to kind of make our population a wee bit younger for a while. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, our working age population is dropping again. But we nearly went below 5 million in 2001. And it was the accession of the Eastern European countries, particularly Polish people, who came here in big numbers, who increased our working age population, increased our population, and made it younger. And the problem is that for many of these populations, there are more going home than are coming. And that means we are in danger. If we do not get power over immigration, it's probably the most important new power we would need is power over immigration. Then we're going to be like St Kilda. You know, in the time that the population in England has quadrupled, ours has only just barely stayed the same. And what we see is you just tilt the UK up, and it's like one of those funny wee games with the balls. All our bright young kids just slide down to the bottom. And I've often said when people talk about benefits of independence, well, I'll tell you one. We pay our share of the civil service. And while there are some civil service jobs in Scotland, I can tell you the big civil service jobs are in the southeast. That's where they buy a house, a car, new curtains, go for a meal. So that money we pay that is our share is spent in the economy of the southeast of England. If we were independent, we'd be spending that money in our own economy. So it wouldn't be being lost to the Scottish government, it would actually be simply going into our economy. It would mean more high quality graduate jobs that would allow fewer of us to end up as Skype grannies, as I call it, and actually have space for our youngest and brightest brains to stay here. Because otherwise people are going to move from the Highlands to the Central Belt, and then they're going to move from the Central Belt south. And that's why these things are so existential for Scotland. If we don't get control of our future, our economy and immigration, we're just going to wither. And that's why the biggest impact will be in Scotland.
A couple of questions here. I wanted to ask about the profile of MEPs, see if there's anything that MEPs could do to actually show the benefits of remaining in the EU, and to convince people that there is no queue, that Scotland would be welcome.
Well, certainly I think Alan Smith tries to do that. And, you know, from his little blue book and his new update, from the articles he's write, again, share them, talk to people about them. I mean, certainly when I'm meeting politicians and others, diplomats and so on, that I meet through working in Westminster, there's an absolute warmth and recognition of Scotland's position. And okay, we might have to go through some paperwork. It might well be that we go into EFTA and the EEA at first. But, you know, the idea that that's where we should stop, people need to look at the difference between EEA and the EU. All the money our local authorities depend on in the European Structural Funds, Regional Development Funds, the Rural Development Funds, sorry, if you're outside the EU, you ain't getting any of that. And if you drove around Scotland in the 80s, every piece of infrastructure that was created in Scotland didn't have a union flag on it, it had stars on it. And it was only money going from Westminster to Europe that ever got money coming back to Scotland. So people need to be aware of that. But again, that would be a decision for after. But to me, the impression I get when I'm speaking to EU politicians or dignitaries is frankly they would like to salvage something from the ashes. They didn't understand, particularly in Germany, they did not understand our wish to be independent in 14. Yeah. Because Germany only unified in 1919. So why on earth would you want to divide up such a moderate, modern, pleasant country as the UK? That's how they see it. From the outside, the UK looks very benign and very moderate. Why would you want to be separatists? When they saw that yellow and blue map, and this includes my relatives in Germany, for the first time, they said, we get it. You are a different country. And so there is an absolute welcome for Scotland to come in to Europe. But the only way they can do that
is if we are independent. Mm-hmm. They will not meddle, and this is a thing people need to understand about Catalonia.
Yeah, yeah.
I was as disappointed as anyone that they did not condemn the violence, which they should have done. But the idea that the EU, which is, if you like, a club of member states, would meddle inside a member state, they won't. They simply won't do that, because the member is Spain. And they like backing up Ireland against the UK, they back the member state. So we have to do the work for us to become a state. But they would be standing there wanting to welcome us in.
Yeah.
And I've even had some say that even if we'd fallen into transition, we would not have deviated yet, and therefore it would be a very short journey to come back into Europe. And we have to get people to understand that, because people will be saying, oh, you'll be outside the UK and you'll be outside the EU. We wouldn't. Our choice, if we were controlling our destiny, is we would be in Europe, because Europe is countries working together. Look at Malta being the president. You know, it doesn't matter what size of country you are. You get your shot at being the president of the European Union. We don't ever get our shot in Westminster.
Philippa, I totally agree with what you're saying moving on about ScotRef, you know, Indy 2, whatever. And I agree that we will need to address the two issues of the pound and the pensions. But Project Fear worked.
Yep.
It had a lot of purchase. And that is what will happen again. So I just wondered, what's your best guess on Project Fear 2?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think, you know, can we focus our minds to look forward and think, it may be that, let's anticipate it this time, let's get our act together.
I think their biggest attack on Project Fear, they will strive and do the pound, the pensions thing again, and that's why we need to be ready to deal with those for the people for whom that was a concern. But their biggest thing will be trying to make out the Kootenai. Scotland's useless, the whole too wee, too poor, too stupid. And, you know, we sit there, we look at Norway, literally the richest country in the world, that has two things. It's got oil and it's got fish. And that's pretty much what Norway has, is oil and fish. And you look at Scotland and we've got oil and we've got fish and we've got whiskey and we've got gaming and we've got biosciences and we've got pharmaceuticals, etc, etc. And the idea... Norway's got a bit of that as well. And our renewables are being held back because Westminster has cut the funding to get these things going forward. And you know, be in no doubt, tidal power that they're working on in the Pentland Firth. You know, tides come to the minute. That becomes part of your baseload. And the other thing, they go, oh, look at those windmills, the wind is, you know, it's cold and frosty, the wind isn't blowing. Yeah, but it's bright and sunny. You know, you need a mix of renewables. And tidal is one of the underpinning, because it's twice a day, to the minute, and it's at a slightly different time all round the coast. But it's being held back because the funding to it has been reduced. That's, again, another decision we would never make. Because as we leave oil behind, or start to leave oil and gas as something that we might turn into other materials, as opposed to setting fire to, we need to be moving into our renewable revolution. And that will certainly be a huge industry. We've got 25% of the kind of offshore wind and tidal power that would be available to Europe. So again, we would be big energy exporters, but this time clean energy. So I think what they'll go for is their usual, and you hear it already in the House of Commons, you know, David Mundell was spouting it on Wednesday. Oh, you export four times as much to England as you export to EU. Okay, well, would you mind telling us how much of what we're sending to you is just going through you?
Yes.
Because our whiskey and our salmon goes to Heathrow and then exits Heathrow from England.
Mm-hmm. And we export utilities, I read. We export water and electricity.
I don't know how much water we're but we certainly export electricity.
So we might charge them more for
it. So part of it is that there are things that we send into England to be exported that do not count as our export. The oil does not count as coming from Scotland. It counts as coming from international waters into England. So the GERS figures, when it comes to what we would actually have as an independent country, does not describe what we have. And there are people who are waking up to that, and therefore we will need to get that. But that's where I think Project Fear will be. Oh, you couldn't survive without us. What, you and your kind of almost 2 trillion debt. You know, this idea that debt in England for the UK is not a problem, but if we had any debt at all, it's a disaster. As I said, all countries other than Norway are in a deficit. But we would not run our economy the way Westminster runs our economy. We would run it to suit the country we live in, and therefore we would claw our way back out of that. And so to me, I'm absolutely waiting for the Growth Commission report. I'm hoping that it'll have answers that we can work around. And then what all of us will have to do is, how do you turn that into English? How do you turn that into things that ordinary people can understand? Because that's where I think Project Fear will be. It'll just simply be, Scotland, uniquely among all the countries in the world, is not fit to make its own decisions and couldn't survive. And we all know that's just balderdash.
Thank you.
So,
just a change of subject. Do you think Theresa May is wise to be dealing with the DUP?
No, I think it's the very short answer. I think, as I said earlier, to hand such a whip hand to, as I say, on an array of parties, the extreme unionist party, and to allow them to obstruct things. In Northern Ireland, there was a majority of people who would have been quite happy with the sort of Irish border in the sea kind of issue. But the DUP wouldn't have it, and obviously they nearly brought down the, or temporarily did bring down the Phase 1 agreement. So I think she's utterly wrong. The idea that they would ever have brought down our government is nonsense. They hate Corbyn with a will. So they would never actually have deliberately brought her down. But by going into an arrangement with her, they have absolutely handed them a whip hand that is not just an issue in Westminster, but as I said, it's a terrible issue for Northern Ireland.
Take a couple more questions and we'll stop for
the
week.
Sure.
Yeah. I just come back to the fear thing that was so prevalent. And my own feelings were that 2014 was great about being positive. But what it seems to be again is that we can say what we can do, what we can do, what we can do. But the snowball effect of, but I'm just a bit scared and I'm just a bit frightened. Now, as you say, whether it be the pensions or the pound, people got a bit frightened. That's not something I think we should be chary of using ourselves. Mm-hmm. And it's not to say that you see everything's bad. But we're always the positive people. Yeah. We need to be telling them, it's bloody shit, this.
We're going to edit that out. The thing is, it's okay, I understand.
But it's only going to get worse. If you think you can sit around for a second time, you get a second chance, and look how brilliant it's been since the first time you went, oh, I don't think I'll bother.
Yeah.
But, excuse me, I don't hear that from the elected politicians who just want to go back down, we can do so much better.
I would totally agree with you, and there were people who said to me that obviously talking about what was happening in the NHS in England was scaremongering and was just negative and that we shouldn't discuss it. I felt that the media in Scotland gave no coverage whatsoever to what was happening in England. It is the public service that right across the United Kingdom people value above all others, and that therefore as part of our decision making we needed to know what was going on and the changes that that might mean for the rest of us in future. When I said that if they go on as they are, they will not have an NHS as they know it basically within 5 years. That isn't just my view, that is now the view of a lot of medical and nursing leaders in England, that their NHS is being pulled apart and that that is going to accelerate with this accountable care issue. So to me, I think when you're actually having this discussion, yes, generally being positive rather than the whole scaremongery thing, but it is pros and cons. Yeah. Any decision we make is what are the pluses, what are the minuses? Yeah. Do the pluses outweigh the minuses? And so to me, I think that you need both.
Yes.
In actual fact, if you go back to the kind of American campaigning where they came away from the, attack and destroy your opposition, instead of talking about what you would do, they still had a little bit of
Trump, of
black and white, of colour in that, so that you're looking at your pros and cons. And I think that's important. And what we need to remember is Project Fear never stopped. The campaign against us never stopped. Our problem is that we kind of went quiet.
Yeah.
And in actual fact, as I said to you, this is the year. You don't have time to wait for a date or independence campaign to be declared. You need to be working on it now.
Yeah, just wanted to ask you if you think there's any chance it won't go ahead.
An independence referendum?
No, Brexit. So.
Sadly, I would love to think that, but to be honest, I think they have simply invested too much. What was ridiculous was that they spent the first year arguing with themselves. It was almost like one of those like, Peanuts cartoons where there's just a big cloud and arms and legs sticking out. So they weren't discussing with the EU. If they had gone to the EU and gone, oh my goodness, we didn't expect that. How do we deal with this? There might have been some sympathy, but what did they do? They strutted up and down for a whole year, being abusive about the EU, being rude, and then suddenly turning around going, well, we want this and this and this and this and this. We're leaving the club, but we still expect to play every Sunday morning, and we want a 20-minute slot on the golf course, and we want to be first out. It's just childish. But the problem is they have talked themselves into that situation, and I think the reason that they're in such a shambles is that they don't really know how to go forward with it. And I think Theresa May has no real achievable vision. Of what Brexit she wants.
So will there be a deal?
Yeah. I think there'll be a deal of some kind, but it just depends on how basic that deal is.
She'll have to accept the European Court of Justice, but otherwise she won't get any deal on the single market, on it, because the EU is quite strong on that.
It's not just the European Court of Justice. You cannot have, and Europe recognises, and the German car manufacturers recognise, and they are not out of line at all, is that if the UK does not pay, is not a member, and yet gets all the benefits, I tell you the EU will fall apart, because there'll be a whole queue of people. Norway is already saying, we pay all this just to be in the EEA. If you give the UK anything like that, without paying, and without being a member, then we're out. So the whole thing would unravel, and they know that. And the big manufacturing companies know that the EU is more important to them, the single market is more important to them, than actually just allowing things to be picked apart.
What do you make as a fisherman in Scotland? I mean, that really is a question. I've been asked this a year ago when I was campaigning in Anwa, somebody with a family in a fisher community, because they are surely now would be understanding that the UK is never going to stand for them. Have you talked to them?
Well, I've spoken to some of my local fishermen, because in the West Coast it's much more fruit de mer rather than whitefish, and 86% of it goes to Europe. So a lot more of them are kind of very frightened about
thinking
it. The people who voted Leave were very much the people who catch the fish. The people who process fish using a lot of EU staff are anxious. The people who have to sell that fish or seafood into the European market are very anxious. And when the people who catch the fish say, oh, Europe has destroyed the industry, well, I think overfishing had something to do with that. I think blackfish had something to do with that. And the fact that we do not have a structure in Scotland where young men and women can get into the industry. In Norway, the fishing industry is very localized. So you have lots more fishing villages that have survived. We have people who own enormous trawlers. It's very hard for someone to actually get into the business. And right now, I can tell you what they're talking to me about, is they can't get crew. So their boats are tied up from Troon up to the Western Isles because they can't get crew. Because their EU staff are not going to come. They can't get Filipino fishermen, who they were delighted to have in the past. And particularly on the West Coast, because it's not international waters. International waters don't start till beyond the Western Isles. So our fishing out of southwest Scotland all counts as the inner waters, and they will not give the right to stay there to Filipino fishermen. It's a lot easier for the northeast because they fish in international waters. So to me, while everyone describes the fishing industry as one big thing, it's not. It's different industries. And the other thing is, they're beginning to probably realise that what they thought they were going to get, they're not going to get. If we had been at the top table as an independent country, Scotland is one of the top four fishing nations in Europe. We would have had a much louder voice in the whole design and running of the Common Fisheries Policy. Whereas what we've had is we've had the UK government trading away a couple of thousand tons of mackerel, which we catch, to get cod, which the fleet in England catches. So quota has been traded away from Scotland, not by Europe, not Europe's fault, but by UK ministers who have never been interested in our fishing industry or our farming industry.
Online. Obviously, the live stream lags slightly behind the actual conversation, but this is quite an interesting one. Patricia Anderson asks, why can't we stop exports going through England? Can we get them to go through Scottish ports instead? Mm-hmm. Is this an option to change this?
Well, obviously, if we ended up even with the compromise deal where we were in the single market and England is not, of course, there's no way that producers would export out of Europe to export back in. But we don't control, certainly from the point of view of air freight, we don't control what's called our fifth freedom rights around exporting. But obviously, to me, this is something that would be a rejuvenation of cargo at Prestwick, would be a rejuvenation of East Coast ports. Because obviously, if we were in Europe and England is outside Europe, we would export directly to Europe. And therefore, that's another way that actually our industries and our economy would be growing. Whereas at the moment, it's up to the person, the manufacturer and exporter, and they choose obviously to send stuff down, goes in the belly of a plane in Heathrow and away it goes. So there would be an absolute change in our export lines if we were in Europe with England outside Europe.
Yeah, this is an difficult one. My daughter was working in Cornwall, staying in a hotel, popcorn and jelly, and on Southwest Television, she's got a long programme about how very poor A&E waiting times had been in Scotland and how we hadn't met any of our targets. And she said, Mum, I thought that the health service was better with you than it is with England. And I said, did they give it as a comparative thing to how the English figures had been? And she said, no, it was just about how terribly bad the NHS was in Scotland. So what is this all about? Are they trying to portray in England that Scotland is failing under having the Scottish government?
Yes.
Is this how they're doing it?
Well, why it was shown in Cornwall, I'm not 100% sure. So it might
that
be
South
on
West Television.
Yeah. So they might have just picked that up from the BBC national stream. But there's no question that that's how it's portrayed to people here in Scotland. It completely does my head in, because I meet people from the NHS in England, but I also meet people from the British Dental Association talking about, I had a meeting last week, we've got Child Smile. Fillings in children are down 24% in Scotland. Full dental clearances, that means removing all the teeth of a child, under general anaesthetic are up 11% in England. Because in England, you do not register with a dentist. In England, a dentist is paid a flat fee. So they get paid a fee like for a checkup, but if they also did fluoride coating and fissure sealing and giving them cleaning advice, they're doing all that for nothing. So it doesn't happen. 40% of children in England can't find a dentist. So, you know, we don't hear that. People up here moan, but they have no idea of the things that we have. So down there, from charities and other groups, I hear, you're so lucky up in Scotland. You've still got a proper NHS. You're so lucky in Scotland. You have this project and that project that they don't have in England. You come over the border, you open any of our newspapers, and you'll have them quoting, Anna Sarwar says the SNP has destroyed the NHS in Scotland. For A&E, we have been the leading performer in the UK since March 2015, every single month. The last time Scotland met the 95% target was August. The last time England met it was July 2015. The last time Wales, run by Labour, met it was 2008. So, you know, you need to recognise there are three main parties in Scotland who bitch about the NHS, Anna Sarwar and Miles Briggs and their compadres. There are three main NHSs in Great Britain run by three different political parties. You just hashtag go compare and decide which one you want to be in. But when I come up here, all I see
is NHS Scotland
yes.
under attack.
Absolutely.
Now,
yes,
okay, absolutely. Now I'm in politics, but I can tell you when we last had this kind of thing, and it was under Mrs. Thatcher, when they were trying to make out that doctors were just one up
yes.
from drug dealers, we were all lazy, and we were all on the golf course or doing private practice, and I was working over 100 hours a week at the time. Coming home from a hard shift, whether you're a nurse or a doctor, and opening a paper that's describing everything you do as failing is really demoralising and demotivating. In my local paper this week, we have shock horror because 50 people waited in our health board over 12 hours in A&E. Now that's awful. I don't want people to be stuck in A&E that time. And yet they admitted the week before it was zero. That tells you it was not a systemic problem. It was the fact that we had all the ice and snow back and we're still in the middle of the flu outbreak. So this is not an underlying structural problem. It's the fact that we're having an absolutely hellish winter.
How do we counteract the negative? Well, the Herald Scotland is one of them. The Herald Scotland every day says this bad story. I'm so fed up with it. I don't even read it.
Well, can I say? Can I say? You need to talk to people and you need to write to the papers. So if you have something that counteracts it, please don't just sit and get annoyed. Counter it. Write in. And talk about, in my local health board, your relative, your experience, and counter that. Because even just, pardon me, for the staff to recognise that people recognise how hard they work, it has been really difficult. And it comes back to this issue of workforce. Longer waiting times will happen if you don't have enough people in clinics, if you are short. And that's why, to me, workforce is one of our biggest challenges that we really have to work out how we tackle. And as I say, if we don't control immigration at the end of all of this, we are in real trouble. So it is telling people the difference. And that's why the space that I live in is what is different between Scotland and England's NHS? What is different between England and Wales' NHS? So when these Tory MSPs and Labour MSPs are always attacking, that you come back and say, well, your party's in charge of an NHS.
Yes.
What decisions are you making there? Because that lets us see what decisions you would make if you were in charge here. It isn't perfect and it's under a lot of strain, there's no question about that. But the underlying principles that we have in Scotland mean that it simply is the strongest of all four health systems in the UK.
Mm-hmm.